Welcome to session 9 of Biostatistics and Biomedical Research. The version of the notes that we're using in today's session is dated January 9th, 2020. If you're watching this live on YouTube, be sure to activate the chat box and set it to live chat. And if you're watching this offline or at any time, please add discussion questions to datamethods.org to the topic devoted to this session. You'll recall that in session 8, we talked about comparing two proportions, which is one of the more simple statistical comparisons we can do, although it's not without some complexity because of the great difficulty of computing very accurate p-values, a subject of much debate among statisticians. Today, what we're going to do is to develop the modeling framework for comparing two proportions, which also allows you to go much beyond that sort of comparison and to adjust for other variables. The model framework, as we have tried to motivate throughout this course, is a preferred framework in modern statistics, at least in the minds of many statisticians, because it's a unifying framework and you don't have to learn so many special cases. And so we're going to show how to embed the problem of comparing two proportions into logistic regression. And this is also an excellent opportunity to introduce logistic regression when you don't have a whole lot of complexities in the covariates. And then we'll see how logistic regression can be extended in many different ways. So please look at the notes and ask your questions during and after the session, and let's get ready to go. When you are comparing two or more groups on a dichotomous outcome, as we did in a 2x2 table, or we used a normal theory-based test, an approximate test to compare two proportions, which involves taking the difference of the two proportions, we have a binary outcome, and we could say that what we're interested in is estimating the probability of that outcome as a function of which group you were in. So if that's all that you have and there's no other lurking variables, you can use the Pearson chi-square test for a contingency table or the less powerful and more problematic Fisher's exact test. But you can do those sorts of analyses using a variety of regression models. And in the two-group case, it doesn't really matter as much which regression model you use as long as it respects the binary nature of the outcome variable. It's really necessary to use a regression model when you want to extend what you're doing. So you want to analyze more than one grouping variable. So you may have two grouping variables, as we'll see in just a moment. Or you might have some other variables that you want to adjust for, some covariates. Now, to choose a regression model that's going to give you the least amount of problems, you want to choose a regression model that doesn't put restrictions on the regression coefficients. So we're talking about categorical outcome data and probabilities. And as you know, probabilities have a definite restriction to be called probabilities. They have to be not less than zero or greater than one. So if you were to use an additive model in a regression framework, since you start adding things that might possibly get greater than one or less than zero, an additive model is not going to be adequate over a wide range of risk. And so we start looking at other models, and if we notice that the odds of the event occurring, which is just the probability in favor of the event divided by the probability against the event happening, that's the odds, that has less of a restriction because it can go up to infinity. If the probability is one, you have infinite odds of something occurring, but it's restricted to be positive. And so there's still a restriction in the odds. If you took the log of the odds, there's no restriction. So as p goes to zero, the log of the odds goes to minus infinity. And then as the odds goes to infinity, the log of that goes to infinity. So Now we have a good basis for modeling because we can model these covariate additive effects and not worry about placing any restrictions on the regression coefficients. And so we're going to use a default assumption that the effects are additive in some scale without a restriction. And when you model this on a scale such as log odds, it will still translate to probabilities that are legal. So the probabilities will be restricted to be in the legal range of 0 to 1. The binary logistic model is the most commonly used model for categorical outcomes. It's used to estimate the probability of an event as a flexible function of covariates. Now, what does the logistic model look like? Well, if we say that our outcome variable y has values of 0, which means no event, or 1, which means an event, we write the model in terms of the probability of the event happening given the covariates, and capital X is going to stand for possibly a vector of covariates. And then you have this logistic function of the covariates and their importance weights, their regression coefficients, and the intercept. So 1 over 1 plus e to the minus, this sum, this quantity in parentheses here is called the linear predictor. And by translating it with this logistic function, we're translating an unrestricted scale to a scale that's restricted from 0 to 1, as you'll see in the plot in just a minute. Now, note that we don't always predict events. We could predict group membership, like what's the probability that someone will have a certain characteristic as a function of some other characteristics they have. So it's not always an event, but we talk about logistic regression as if the outcome is an event. So the binary logistic model relates the linear predictor, or LP, that doesn't need to have any restrictions, to the event probability. And when you plot that relationship from that 1 over 1 plus e to the minus type of function, you get this graph. And you can see that the logistic function makes things slow down so that the probabilities don't go negative on the left, and makes it slow down so they don't go above 1 on the right. So you have this sort of S-shaped curve. It's really important to note that you don't actually observe curves like this with real problems, because it's very uncommon that we're going to have a problem where the probabilities go almost to 0 and almost to 1 for different subjects in the same problem. So we often are operating in a certain range. We might be operating in this range here. And so what we observe might be a piece of this curve, not the whole curve. Now, there's some things to understand related to that. I just mentioned this first one. A second thing about the linear predictor and how you envision this in a graph is, if a certain predictor, let's say it's x sub j for the jth covariate, if it has a non-zero effect, and the predictor is categorical, let's say it's binary or it's discrete, like a discrete ordinal value, the linear predictor cannot take on all possible values because of the discreteness of the x. And so when you envision that S-shaped plot we just looked at, it'll have gaps in it when you have categorical x. Now, we're leading up to a fuller discussion of logistic models by considering our special case that we went through in detail in session 8. And so, as a special case, the logistic model can estimate and compare two probabilities, and it's done through an odds ratio. So when you're estimating just two probabilities, say in our case study in the last session, what's the probability of dying with open heart surgery if you were an emergency case versus a non-emergency case? Seems like an overkill to use logistic regression here, but it will set the stage for much more complex and interesting analyses, as well as Bayesian analysis. It'll have a lot of advantages. So for our case, we're going to have the X's that go into that linear predictor are just going to denote a group membership. So our group is going to be, say, emergency versus non-emergency case. We're going to make the reference group be group A, and the alternate group be group B. And this bracket notation is denoting a 1. So this is a notation for an indicator variable or a dummy variable. This is going to denote a 1 if what's inside the bracket is true, and 0 if it's false. And then we're going to define the xpit function is the inverse of the logit function. So the logit function is the log of the odds, or the log of p over 1 minus p. If you were to reverse that and to solve for p, given the log odds, you get this function here, which is just the logistic function. So that logistic function is also called the xbit function. So we're going to talk about logit and xbit. Those are just opposites of each other. So one is the inverse function of the other. So when you write your binary logistic model for this simple two-group problem, you're just going to have one indicator variable, the indicator of being in the non-reference group when you have only two groups. And then you're going to have an intercept, and you're going to have the effect of being in group B, which is a difference from group A to group B on the log odds scale. The probability of the outcome given the group is a function of the group and of these two regression coefficients. Now you can write the probability of the event as xbit of beta 0 plus beta 1 times the indicator of whether or not you're in group B. So let's write out the two cases, group A versus group B. So if you're in group A, this indicator variable is 0, so you just have beta 0. So the probability of the event if you're in group A is the xbit of beta 0, and the probability of the event if you're in group B is the xbit of beta 0 plus the group effect beta 1. So we see there's a shift in the log odds. Beta 1 is the increase in log odds of the outcome as you move from group A to group B. Beta 0 is the log odds of the base probability. So if you're in the reference group of group A, and let's say the probability event for the group A is P1 and for group B is P2, then beta 0 is the log of the odds, and we use logit to mean that function. Logit is the log of the odds, or the log of P1 over 1 minus P1. And then beta 1 is the increase in log odds as you go from group A to group B. So beta 1 is equal to the logit of P2 minus the logit of P1. And if you take the anti-log of beta 1, instead of having a log odds ratio or an increase in logit as you go from group A to group B, you're going to have the ratio of odds. So the anti-log of the difference in log odds is just the odds ratio. So the ratio of odds from being in group B compared to being in group A is the anti-log of beta 1. And so now the probability of being in group A is just, again, the xbit of beta 0. The probability of being in group 2 or group B is the xbit of the sum of the two coefficients. Now, once you estimate the betas, which we estimate using maximum likelihood estimation, which is for another day, we quickly get the B to A odds ratio, and we quickly get P1 hat and P2 hat, the maximum likelihood estimates of P1 and P2. Now, we're talking about a very simple model. There's only two possible predicted values you can get from this model. And the problem is a very simple model because there's only two groups and there's no background covariates. We're not taking age or anything else about the patient into account. So the model that we've chosen to use is a saturated model. A saturated model is one that has the maximum number of parameters needed to fully describe the situation. So this situation, there's two groups, so we would need two parameters. And those two parameters will allow us to estimate anything possible about the probabilities of outcome for those two groups. Now, a saturated model if you ignore distributional assumptions and independence assumptions for now, so we're assuming, say, if you have patient data that different patients are operating independently of each other, they're not competing with each other, the saturated model has to fit the data. And so there's no question of need to look at lack of fit in a model that's saturated, other than looking at other assumptions like distributional or variance assumptions. Now, the logistic model doesn't have any variance assumption, and it doesn't have any distributional assumption. So in this particular model that we're developing, there's absolutely nothing to examine given the assumption of independence of the different subjects holds. Now, logistic regression is much more general and flexible than the specialized test for proportions. As I've mentioned before, it allows testing for association on continuous characteristics. It easily allows you to extend to more than two groups, allows for adjustment for covariates. So what do we mean by extending to more than two grouping variables? Let's suppose you are interested in assessing the effect of a subject's sex, being male or female, and what country the subject is from, on the probability that something is true or some event happens. And so if that probability is P, then our model is going to look like this. The logit of the probability of the event happening is equal to some constant, which is beta zero, plus the male effect on the logit scale, plus the Canada effect on the logit scale. So now you see we have a two-way sort of situation, and we're assuming the effect of being male and the effect of being from Canada are additive on the log odd scale. You can also allow for interaction, and now this is going to give you a saturated model that would have to fit the data. So when you have interaction in the model, your model would look like the logit of probability of y is equal to 1 is equal to a constant plus the male effect plus the Canada effect plus a special effect of being male if you happen to be Canadian. So that's one way to state an interaction effect. So that's a saturated model. It has 3 degrees of freedom plus the intercept. So it has 4 parameters in all, and 4 parameters will exactly estimate any 4 proportions. So there's no assumption in this model. But unlike the Pearson chi-square, which you can do a Pearson chi-square that has 4 groups versus a 2-level outcome variable, here we can do something more than just see if there's a difference among 4 proportions, but we can allow testing for interaction between country and sex. We can also do something you can't do with a regular chi-square, which is to get separate effects of sex and country, and you can get the overall effect of the sex variable. That would be a 2 degree of freedom chunk test for whether there is a sex difference for either Canada or the U.S. And that's allowing for the sex effect to be different in the two countries. So this is a general test of the sex effect that doesn't assume the sex effect is the same, but asks, is there a difference between the sexes in either the U.S. or Canada? That's a 2 degree of freedom test that you really couldn't get with an ordinary Pearson contingency table chi-square test. Now, one complexity of using logistic models is there's multiple choices you can make for the test statistic that you can use. There's 3 commonly used test statistics. There's the likelihood ratio test, which is usually the most accurate and has a real advantage that it's scale invariant. In other words, if you test on the original absolute risk scale versus you test on the logit scale, the chi-square value is going to be unchanged. And there is a likelihood ratio test that you can get that's just a function of the proportions, like the 2 proportions. It's logarithmic function in those 2 proportions and their 2 sample sizes. And that likelihood ratio test for a 2x2 table is identical in value to the likelihood ratio test from the logistic model. The second type of test is the score test, which looks at the slope of the log likelihood or derivative. And if your model is saturated, that's going to be identical to the Pearson chi-square value. And then there's a test we use most often because it's simplest, and that is the wall test. And a wall test is a chi-square test that takes the square of an estimate divided by the standard error in the one parameter case, and it easily generalizes to a multi-parameter case, just like the likelihood ratio and score tests do. The wall test is the one that you see all the time because we like to look at the betas and we automatically get standard errors of those betas. Whereas the likelihood ratio test, you have to omit a variable and refit the model and see how much the likelihood suffers to get that particular statistic. But the wall test has problems. So if you have an effect that starts to approach an odds ratio of infinity, the beta hat will be really large as a log odds ratio, but the standard error gets large faster than the beta does. So the ratio of those two actually goes to zero. So you could have a very, very important variable that appears to have no importance at all. The wall test is easiest to compute, but it's not as accurate. The score test is the way to exactly get what the regular contingency table of chi-squared is. But we typically use the wall test and the likelihood ratio, but for anything of pivotal importance, it's good to use the likelihood ratio test, and it's good to use confidence intervals that are derived from the likelihood ratio test, which are called confidence profiles or profile likelihood confidence intervals. Now, once you learn the logistic model framework, you don't need to have a way to compare two proportions anymore. Now, there's three usages of the test statistics. There's the individual test, which would be, say, what's the sex effect in a model that doesn't have interaction in it. You can do a chunk test, which would be, is there a difference between males and females for either Canada or U.S.? That is a chunk test combining the effect of the sex main effect and the country by sex interaction, so that has two total degrees of freedom. And then there's the global test of no association, which would be a 3-degree freedom test if you had interaction here. And that's a test for whether sex or country, either one, is associated with the outcome variable. So let's work through this and actually fit a logistic model for our two-sample comparison, which is our emergency surgery for patients getting coronary bypass surgery. We're going to, instead of starting with a frequency table, we're going to string out the observations into a tall and thin format, and we can do that by just replicating some of the values. And when you put that into a tall and thin data set that has the right frequencies and you ask to tabulate those, what's the relationship between the priority variable and the death variable, you see the tabulation that we had before. Now, in the RMS package in R, it has one little trick that you need to do, which is to run your data frame or your variables through the data dist function so that it knows about the covariate distribution and it knows how to easily get plots and predicted values. But the workhorse here is the LRM function, and that is for binary and ordinal logistic regression. And so we say that our outcome variable death is modeled as a function of the surgical priority, and that gives us a fit object which we can print by just naming the object. And you see this output, and you see we had 17 deaths, 119 alive, we had 136 patients in all. The likelihood ratio test for asking whether priority is associated with mortality has a chi-square of 3.2 and a p-value of 0.07 using the fairly accurate likelihood ratio test. There's some generalized R-squared and various other measures and measures of rank discrimination of the model, rank correlation between predicted and observed outcomes, predicted probability and observed outcomes, a variety of indexes we won't really get into for this simple model. That'll be for later. And then we have our model output. So we see our estimate of beta 0 is minus 2.2 with this standard error. The ratio of those and squared is equal to, if you don't square that and just take the ratio, you get minus 6.95 as the walled Z statistic with this p-value. Now that p-value should actually be erased. There's nobody who's interested in knowing whether the intercept is equal to zero. The intercept is in the model to handle the overall prevalence of the outcome. We're really interested in beta 1, and our maximum likelihood estimate of beta 1 is equal to 1.0546 with this standard error. And we get a walled p-value of 0.06, which is smaller than the likelihood ratio chi-square test p-value. And the likelihood ratio chi-square statistic of 3.2 is smaller than the Pearson chi-square, which here is the score test that we had in the last session. We got a 3.7. So anything can happen on a given data set, but that's no reason to doubt the likelihood ratio chi-square test. Any of these test statistics are approximate there because we're approximating the true sampling distribution of the chi-square statistic, and it's kind of disappointing that we have to make approximations in such a simple model, and it's a good reason to use Bayesian methods, which do not need to make those approximations. Now let's see if we know how to interpret the model and see if we can recover the proportions of deaths for the non-emergency and for the emergency cases. So if you take the x bit of minus 2.2073, which is beta 0, so that's equal to 1 over 1 plus e to the minus 2.2, you get 0.099, which is exactly 11 out of 111, which is the simple proportion of deaths in that group. To get the estimate of the probability of death in the emergency group, we take the intercept and we add to it the group effect. In this case, it's the emergency effect because the non-emergency is taken as a reference cell. And this notation here in the output is telling us this is a non-reference cell. So if you add those two numbers together and take the exponent of that, you get 0.24, which is exactly 6 divided by 25, the proportion you would get from just looking at the raw data. Now, when we look at the summary function in the RMS package, you see that it's getting us the odds ratio, not telling us much we already didn't know, but it's just anti-logging the effect. So the effect on the logistic scale is 1.0546, as we just saw, and if you anti-log that, you get 2.87. And if you take the confidence intervals for the log of the odds of dying, and you put those through the anti-log function, you get the confidence intervals quite easily, based on the approximate walled method, of 0.95 to 8.7. And so you can compare those to a confidence interval that's not using the logistic model. The odds ratio that we got earlier, which didn't seem to use a logistic model, is actually exactly the same as what we get here. So we had a formula for the standard error of the log odds ratio. In this simple saturated model, it's exactly what you get as a standard error from the regression coefficient in the logistic model. Now, to set us up for something we're going to study with the Bayesian logistic model, we're going to add an unnecessary random binary variable to the logistic model, and it's one that has the potential to mess us up because it's correlated with the variable of interest, the surgical priority. So we're going to get a uniform 0-1 variable that's the same length as the number of patients in the data set, and we're going to create a random variable that such that if the priority was emergency, we're going to say we're going to have an indicator of whether the random number was less than a third, and if it was not emergency, we're going to set the random variable to 1 if the uniform variable was greater than a third. So it'll be set to 1 twice as often in the non-emergency group. So we're going to add that variable. It's a 0-1 variable to our data set. It's a variable that was generated randomly. So it's generated to be correlated with the other predictor in the model, but it should be irrelevant to the outcome. And we can look at how the surgical priority and the random variable relate to each other, and there is a pretty strong relationship. Now, what happens when you fit a logistic model that has our main variable of interest and it has this noise variable in it? We see our chi-square went up because just by random luck, this noise variable seemed to have some association with the outcome variable. And you can see that the walled Z statistic is -1.6 and the p-value is 0.09. If this was a zero, we would get the same estimates of these as we had ignoring that variable. But since it did not come out zero, these estimates are changed a fair amount in view of the fact that the random 0-1 variable we've added has a correlation with this priority variable. And so we have really diminished the effect of emergency surgery status by adding that group variable that has no relationship to death in the population, but it has a fairly large apparent effect. So that's a real problem. So we'll see in the Bayesian world, you might say, well, we may have some prior knowledge that this was somebody's dream of a variable. They really had some wild reason why this variable should be important. But based on everything we know about medicine, it should not be very important. And so we're going to put some prior knowledge on the effect of that variable. We'll see that's very easy to do. So as we do the Bayesian counterpart to what we just have done with the two-group comparison, and also we'll see when we add the noise variable, we'll recognize that the Bayesian approach has several advantages. So you don't have all this debate about whether you need something like Fisher's exact test. All the calculations are exact to within simulation error, and if you wanted the simulation error to go to zero, you just simulate more and more samples from the posterior distribution of the parameters in this model. So you can get as exact as you want, and once you get up to around 50,000 draws from the posterior distribution using Monte Carlo simulation, you essentially have exact values that are fully reproducible, but we typically sample only about 4,000 from the posterior because it usually doesn't matter too much, but for something very pivotal, you would sample much more. What's another advantage of Bayes? You can incorporate external information. You have intuitive measures of evidence. This is probably the biggest single advantage of Bayes. And it automatically handles zero frequency cells. So if you had, in a given cell, everyone in that cell had an event, but there are only three people in that cell, the maximum likelihood estimate is an odds ratio of infinity, which will give you an absolute risk of 1.0, but most people would not believe that's a valid estimate. And Bayes would, depending on how you set your priors, would automatically discount that 3 out of 3 and give you something that's not as close to 1.0 in the probabilities. It's now, the way we usually learn how to deal with proportions with Bayes is, as we first saw when we had a single proportion, we used a beta distribution prior for the proportion, which is flexible enough, and it gives you a beta distribution posterior distribution for the probability, for the unknown probability that you're trying to estimate. It's very, very simple, and most people probably use that same approach with beta priors for each of the two probabilities in the two-group problem, but there's some real issues with that, and we really need to incorporate a dependency in the two priors. And to have correlated priors in the two probabilities, P1 and P2, adds a lot of complexities, and it's not very easy to do that. Now, why do I say we need to say that our knowledge about the two probabilities is correlated? Why do we have knowledge about maybe they're more similar to each other than they are different? Well, we usually know more about a group effect or a treatment effect than we know about the base probabilities. And so P1 and P2 are going to depend on how sick the patients are that actually get into your study, and that's somewhat unpredictable, and it might have a wide range. And so we have less knowledge about the probability of the outcome in any one group than we have about how the probability of the outcome for one group relates to the probability of the outcome for another group. So logistic model gives you a very natural way to deal with that. So we're going to have a wide prior on P1 because we don't know very much about the probability of mortality, say, in the non-emergency group. And then we're going to have a prior on the log odds ratio, but that prior is not going to be flat. And so that prior is going to be a little bit concentrated towards zero because we're going to assume that the mortality of the emergency cases is more similar to the mortality of the non-emergency cases than they are different. So given a prior distribution on the log odds ratio, the log odds ratio connects the two probabilities on the original scale, and you can backsolve and show what dependency between the knowledge of P1 and P2 is induced by having a prior on the log odds ratio that's not flat. So we're going to use the same data model as we talked about before, and we're going to use, as we've used before, the BRMS package in R, which makes standard modeling easy. And we need two priors. We need a prior for the intercept beta 0, and we need a prior for the log odds ratio, which is beta 1. So for beta 0, it's convenient to use a normal distribution, and we're going to say that a 0.05 chance of dying might be the single most likely value for the probability of dying. And we're going to put on the log odds scale, we're going to put a mean of that prior distribution at the logit of 0.05, which is minus 2.944. And we're going to have a variance of that prior such that there's only a 1 chance in 10 that the probability of dying is higher than 0.2. And then we're going to solve for the standard deviation that accomplishes that. Because we're going to do this multiple times in the future, we're going to have a little function called norm solve, and this just solves for the standard deviation so that the tail area of the normal distribution beyond a certain value is this probability given by prob. And so you can specify the mu and the point that you're defining as the tail of the distribution and the tail probability, and this will give you the value of standard deviation. And so for our particular case, that standard deviation that satisfies what's up here is 1.216. So now we have a normal distribution for the log odds if you're a non-emergency patient. And then for beta 1, we're going to put a prior that has an equal chance for the odds ratio being less than 1 as being greater than 1. Using clinical knowledge, we would have actually put more chance of the odds ratio being greater than 1 than being less than 1. But this is a bit conservative. And we're going to use a mean for the log odds ratio of 0, which means that you have a 0.5 probability on the left for this and a 0.5 probability on the right. We're going to put a chance of only 1 out of 10 that the odds ratio is greater than 3. So in the norm solve function, will tell us what standard deviation to use for beta 1, and that's 0.857. So now before we get into actually doing the Bayesian model, we can start to understand the prior knowledge and the parameters by just doing some very simple calculations. So what is the correlation of our knowledge about P1 and our knowledge about P2? So we can draw 100,000 samples from the prior distribution almost instantly. First thing we can do, and we can also verify that the prior probability that P2 exceeds P1 is a half, which is also the prior probability that the odds ratio is greater than 1. So how do we do that? Well, the normal distribution with a mean of logit of 0.05 and a standard deviation of 1.216 is our prior distribution for beta 0. So we're going to get a sample of 100,000 of those beta 0 values, and then we're going to get 100,000 beta 1 values. So beta 1 has a prior mean of 0 and a prior standard deviation of 0.857. So that's how easy it is to sample that with our norm. And now we can convert those prior regression coefficients to absolute probability. So now we have 100,000 values of P1, and then P2 is just the x bit of beta 0 plus beta 1. So we have 100,000 values of P2. So what is the Spearman correlation between beta 0 and beta 1? Well, you see these priors are derived to be independent of each other. They don't have any interconnection. And so the correlation is really 0, and with 100,000, we're approximating 0 pretty well. What is the correlation between P1 and P2? Well, our state of knowledge about P1 and P2 has a pretty big correlation, because by assuming the mortality is more similar than different, we're saying that P1 is going to be similar to P2 in our prior belief. And so the Spearman correlation between P1 and P2 in the absence of any data, so this is all using the prior distribution, is 0.8. So now we're going to define functions as we've done before to make things notationally very intuitive. What is the posterior probability function, capital P? It's just the mean of a bunch of indicators of when a condition holds. When you take the mean of all those zeros and ones, you get the proportion of ones, which over our thousands of posterior draws is estimating the probability that the condition holds. And then we're going to have a simple function for the posterior mode. So the first thing we're going to do is to calculate the probability that P2 is greater than P1 prior to having data, and we see that's a half. That's also the probability that beta 1 is greater than 0, which is our log odds ratio, which is also the probability that the odds ratio is greater than 1. Those are all equal to a half to within our simulation error with 100,000 draws from the prior distribution. Now, let's also repeat those calculations to show that the prior knowledge about P1 and P2 would be uncorrelated if we don't know anything about the odds ratio. So one way to say we don't know anything about the odds ratio is to say the variance is infinite, so you get a flat prior distribution. Or you could just set the standard deviation of 1,000, because that's a huge number. It's flat, at least to the human eye. So if you used that prior distribution for beta 1 and you recalculated these 100,000 beta 1 draws from the prior distribution, and you recalculated P2 and calculated the correlation, you see that the correlation is 0 to within simulation error. So if we were to say we have no knowledge about the log odds ratio or odds ratio, that's the same in this model as saying that we have no connection in our prior knowledge about P1 and P2. And we could have easily used that for our main analysis. But we're going to do the Bayesian analysis using the prior that we had earlier, which is a non-flat prior. And so we're going to get access to all of our CPU cores on our machine very easily. So those can be run simultaneously and heat up your computer a bit. We're going to define our prior for beta 0, and that's an intercept prior. And then a prior for beta 1, which is a regression coefficient prior. So this is how we tell the BRMS package these priors go with which parameters. And now we have our model. It has the same notation as the frequentist logistic model. BRM is the main modeling function in the BRMS package. And we give it our data set, which is that tall and thin raw observations. And then we give it the prior, which is a combination of two prior distributions in this object P over here, and family equals Bernoulli. So we're telling it we're not going to use the default, which would be a linear model with ordinary regression for a continuous variable, but our variable death has a Bernoulli distribution. A Bernoulli distribution is just a binary variable that has a certain probability of being a 1. So you almost don't need to call that a distribution because it's such a simple distribution. But this is how we're telling it. We have a 0-1 random variable. And by default, for this family, BRM is going to use the logistic function. This is called using a logit link in the modeling. So our regression coefficients are going to be on the logit scale, just as we're used to doing. So when we look at the output, we see that the link is the logit scale, as I just mentioned. This is our model. This is our number of observations. We did four restarts of the process to get some independent posterior draws. And then we see the posterior means for our two regression coefficients of -2.19 and 0.72. And we get credible intervals for those, which have a probability of 0.95 of containing the true unknown regression coefficients. We have some statistics that make us comfortable about the convergence of this Monte Carlo process for our purposes. And then we can plot the fit object, which plots our estimates of the posterior densities, our posterior distributions. This is the beta 0 posterior distribution, and this is the beta 1 posterior distribution. And then we can do all sorts of things with these posterior draws. So we're going to capture the fit object into a data frame. I think we've done that previously in another example. And that's just going to give us a data frame that contains all the posterior draws. So to go back for a minute, remember Bayes is strange in that we're not sampling patients, we're sampling parameter values from the model's beta parameters. And that's what these samples are in W. We're going to pull off the one parameter, which is for the intercept. So we're going to call that B0. And we're going to pull out of W the parameter for the emergency surgery effect, which is our log odds ratio, which is B1. And now we're going to just put together the posterior mean, posterior median, and posterior mode of these parameters, as well as a derived parameter. See how easy it is to get these posterior estimates, point estimates, for the odds ratio by just anti-logging B1. So when you look at that, you see the posterior means and the posterior median and posterior mode, they're all a little bit different from one another, a little bit more different for B1. And then you see the 3-point estimates for the odds ratio. Now, Bayes doesn't really want you to focus on one point estimate. It really wants you to focus on the entire uncertainty of the problem and the point estimate that you choose to represent the central tendency of your posterior distribution is a bit arbitrary, and only having a loss function might guide you into choosing which one that you really want, but it's often better not to choose any and just use the posterior density as your final representation and to show credible intervals and other things. But see how easy it is to get the 0.95 credible interval for beta 0. We did that before, and how easy it is to get posterior mean, median, and mode for the anti-log of B1. Now, the prior that we use for the odds ratio is conservative. So our prior distribution is not flat, which is effectively what the frequentist method is assuming. It's allowing you to have wild, crazy big values of the log odds ratio, and it's saying that any value on the real line is likely going before you have any data. Whereas our prior distribution has a normal distribution with a finite variance, and it's a somewhat small variance, and so that prior distribution is saying it's unlikely to have enormous odds ratios. And so when you compare these numbers, let's say the posterior mode would be the thing that's most comparable to the maximum likelihood estimate, which is a kind of, it is a most likely value, like a mode. The 2.87 is what we had before. Now we have only a 1.7. So we have a more conservative analysis because of our prior. Now we can get credible intervals for the log odds ratio and the odds ratio. For the log odds ratio, we saw this in the main output from the BRM function, but we can get it again, get exactly the same thing it did by just taking the 0.025 and 0.975 quantiles of these thousands of posterior draws, and you get this. And if you wanted to take the quantiles of the analogs, you're going to get now the credible interval on the odds ratio scale very easily, which is also exactly the same thing as analogging the credible interval endpoints that we had on the log odds ratio scale. We can get the posterior density of the odds ratio, which we didn't have in our standard output for BRM. So to do that, we just say plot of the density function estimate of the analog of B1. And we can also put reference lines at, say, a 1.0 and at the posterior mode for the analog of B1s. And we can calculate the probability that the odds ratio is greater than 1, and that's 0.92. So what is this, and the probability that the odds ratio is large, and let's say large is 1.5, it has to be smaller than this. So the probability the odds ratio is greater than 1.5 is equal to 0.75. So let's look at our estimate of the posterior distribution of the odds ratio. And this is where the posterior mode was put. It's just actually looking up this curve and finding out where the peak was. So it has to agree with the peak here by definition. And then this is the reference for odds ratio of 1. So the probability the odds ratio is greater than 1 is going to be the area to the right of this vertical line all the way out. So the way that you think about this posterior density is, for any odds ratio, given the data and given our prior distributions, what is our degree of belief or what is our evidence for that value of the odds ratio being the 1? So we have the whole possible range of odds ratios and the evidence for that odds ratio, no matter what odds ratio you're currently talking about. That's why a posterior distribution gives you so much information compared to just point estimates and credible intervals, because it gives you the evidence about all possible values. Whereas in the frequentist world, we usually think about a few select hypothesized values. Here it's all possible values. Now, even though the priors for the intercept and the log odds ratios are independent, those two parameters are connected in the data likelihood, just like they're connected in the frequentist world. When you look at the estimate of the intercept and the estimate of the group effect, here the emergency surgery effect, those two estimates are going to be correlated. In an ordinary linear model, you can make them uncorrelated by centering the data to have a mean of 0. But in general, they're going to be correlated. And we can get Spearman correlations of the posterior draws. And so let's start by getting the correlation between the posterior values of beta 0 and the posterior values of beta 1. And we see that those are fairly strongly negatively correlated. So before we have any data, they are uncorrelated. But after data, they're correlated because the data likelihood, that's a big part of the posterior distribution, the biggest part, in the data likelihood, they're correlated. What is the correlation between the estimated, between the calculated values of the probability of death in the non-emergency group and the probability of death in the emergency group? Well, those have a correlation of 0.138. Their correlation is actually smaller than what we had before. Now, what about having a very skeptical prior for a parameter? Let's go back to adding that random group variable to the model, as we do with a frequentist analysis. And we're going to have prior information that that variable is unlikely to be important. And the way we're going to encode that is to put a prior on the log odds ratio for that variable that's centered at zero with a chance that the odds ratio is greater than 1.25 is only 1 out of 20. So using norm solve, we're going to have a zero as our mean, and then we're going to have our cut is going to be at the odds ratio 1.25, so we're on the beta 1 is the log odds ratio scale, so we take log of that. And then the probability of being in that right tail in the prior distribution is only 0.05, so our prior standard deviation would need to be 0.14 to make that happen. So now we're going to add to our prior, we're going to keep these two as before, but now we have a new coefficient, and we're going to call this, we can refer to this in the BRMS notation as the prior that goes with the priority emergency, and this one is the prior that goes with this separate variable, which happened to be called random. It's a 0-1 variable. So now we have a model that has the random added to it. We have an expanded list of priors, and then we're going to look at our analysis, and we can see that our effect of this random 0-1 variable is in the posterior mean is much, much less than what we estimated using maximum likelihood estimate using the frequentist method. So our prior knowledge now is giving a lot of weight to the prior belief of values being close to zero, and we're going to make the data really, really have to convince us that this thing we're calling random has a lot of importance. Now, if you were to repeat this analysis as the sample size grows, this prior would wear off and the analysis would automatically trust the data. You would see the values getting bigger here. So the effect of random is greatly discounted, and the posterior mean priority effect and its credible interval is virtually the same as a model that excluded the random variable because of this discounting by having a very skeptical prior for the effect of this random group variable we've added to the model. Before closing, I want to note that Ray and Reimer have a very nice tutorial on using the BRMS package for binary logistic regression, which you can get to by clicking this link. So I hope you've enjoyed the session. Hope you will ask a lot of questions, because you can get help for free on datamethods.org for this session. And I will see you next time.